Afternoon and welcome to today's webinar on the South African mushroom industry, building forward better. And today we have Professor Lise Korsten, who is co-director at the University of Pretoria Centre of Excellence for Food Security, as well as an editor of the journal Food Security. Food safety is clearly an essential element of food security. Much of Professor Korsten's work has focused on managing human pathogens in food. In particular, Lise and her team have conducted extensive research on E. coli and salmonella in soil, irrigation water, and on leafy greens. In 2017 to 2018, an outbreak of listeriosis in South Africa brought concerns with food safety to the fore. And Lise worked extensively with government agencies to review and improve policies of regulations, setting up a national framework for a new food control authority. We are very pleased that Lise has agreed to participate in our international reference group for our project on mushroom food safety, led by the AMGA. A pathologist by trade, Lise, Professor Korsten also works on post-harvest management of rots and quality. She's been active in developing biological solutions, including patenting commercial products. But most importantly for us, 16 years ago, Lise started the South African Button Mushroom Research Group at Pretoria University. The group has worked with the fledgling African mushroom industry on casing materials, microbes in compost, and management of diseases, including cobweb. The mushroom industry in South Africa has and does face many challenges, including recent unrest. But Lise is passionate about both food security and food safety. Mushrooms may be where these intersect, offering communities a way to safely grow nutritious and healthy food. So please type in your questions during the webinar. Don't just wait until the end. Also note that the webinar is being recorded. We will send a link to everyone who registered and it will be available through our website. So please feel free to share it with anyone you think will be interested. This webinar is brought to you thanks to the Marsh Lawson Mushroom Research Centre, which is funded through the Mushroom Levy with funds from the Australian Government. Over to you, Lise.
Thank you very much. And it's wonderful to be part of this audience. Thank you for the invitation. And I'm really looking forward to this presentation. I'm quickly screening, just doing my screen share, and I hope you can all see my screen. Is that good? Okay.
Yeah, that's good. So, thanks, Lise.
Okay. In the light of COVID, I thought it more appropriate to really focus on building forward better, focusing on mushrooms as a global food source. And really today is going to be about five key messages. I changed my talk a little bit. And I'm going to just touch on the mushroom knowledge platform, and of course, food safety, because this is part of the food safety program. And I also want to just refer to some of our mushroom research in South Africa. First, interestingly, we have published quite a few books in South Africa at the University of Pretoria. We've now published a second book from our group. This was originally Professor Albert Eicher, and more recently, Professor Grijsenhout, Mushroom Collecting. Although these books are very popular, mushroom collecting is not a big activity in South Africa. But what is interesting to note, I refer to knowledge in a book box, is to note what's happening in the social media. There's, for instance, YouTube activities. There's a new Facebook platform in South Africa with already 17,000 members. There's the Mushroom Guru, the Gourmet Mushroom Academy. There's blogs. And then there's another interesting campaign where you refer to Arrive Alive, where they actually advise in terms of mushroom poisoning. So these are, to me, very interesting. So there's a lot of activity on social media. And of course, then there's also a lot of website apps, how to produce your own mushrooms, how to harvest mushrooms. And during COVID, these became very popular in South Africa, mushroom home growing kits. So the industry is most certainly changing. We have been running a very powerful campaign, the Pink Campaign. This is Ross Richardson. And it was interesting to note that this campaign brought in just over $5 million, rand, in this period, just a nine-year period, where people would donate a one rand from the planet, Pink Planets, towards cancer research. So they talk about the power of pink. It's been successful in South Africa. And there's also more recently a shifting emphasis in food security on people eating more mushrooms, and particularly from a nutritional point of view, and also, of course, the anti-cancer properties. What is interesting is the focus on vitamin D. And of course, with COVID, where people are encouraged to increase their vitamin D, we thought this was quite an interesting angle for the mushroom industry. I have to mention a few key impact factors of COVID. And this was very interesting because these were the take-home messages from the Produce Marketing Association, one of the meetings in the USA. And I thought that the most interesting to me was general shift towards improved hygiene, sanitation, and specifically hand hygiene. So our research, we've just published a paper on staphylococcus, and staphylococcus is transferred through handling. And we actually could show that between the pickers and the packers, we had a significant shift of staphylococcus and our different staphylococcus species purely based on handling. We also currently have a study looking at the impact of hand sanitizers on hand microbiology. So there's a different microflora. There's a different way of people cleaning and sanitizing. And I think that's most probably the only good spin-off from COVID. But there's also an interesting shift in South Africa where people are more considering holding government responsible. And to what we saw during the COVID period, that there was a definite shift in trust in growers. So people trusted the agricultural industry because during the COVID lockdown, they were the people who still distributed food. And actually, they donated food to the people that was informal settlements and really under dire need and in a critical situation. So there's three interesting shifts. Now, according to PMA, the consumer also have been challenged with food choices. And they talk about the post-pandemic shocking period that's going to emerge and how people will do different and buy different. And I just remember listening to a conversation about hamburgers being delivered. There is a new buyer attitude where people are looking at food, the way they buy food, the choices they make, the delivery of food, and also value of food. So there's definitely a consumer shift that I think we need to take note of. And of course, cooking is cheaper at home, where you as a consumer can control the product, the tastes, etc. I know this campaign focusing on more healthy eating has been taken up by Tesco in the UK, and this was published recently in CNN. So there's definite post COVID impacts for the industry. In South Africa, we, of course, had an additional system shock. And this is actually Durban. And these are the ports, container depots that was looted and burned and totally destroyed. And I think this was a shock and something nobody saw. This was just the first 2 days following big looting in KwaZulu-Natal, and these were just some of the news flashes that came through, but the impact of this was huge. I just want to highlight a few interesting things. For some reason, these guys stole bullets. There was chemists were raided, medical factory plants were burned down. There's suddenly now a shortage of chronic medication. What was also very interesting was there was attacks on three telecommunications, the airport, and of course the port was totally blocked. So all the fresh produce standing in containers at the ports could not move. And the most important, they burned down all the transport trucks on the highways. We were actually traveling on that highway at the time. So I saw those burning trucks. It was mind-boggling. So a lot of big stores were burned down. We are busy counting the costs and the implications of it. Obviously, liquor outlets, all the malls, all the warehouses. It was unbelievable. I actually made this map for my students within the first 2 weeks or within the first week after the looting. And it's a little bit busy, but I just want to take you around this, which we were seeing unfolding in front of us. And it reminded me very much in terms of what happened with Donald Trump in the USA. But it was all about timing. It was, of course, the hearing of our previous president. It was about communication, using all these platforms. They also destroyed some of the cell phone shops. They used social media. Then all the critical routes, the ports, containers, depots, and then the intelligence on the ground was totally not in place. So there was pockets of people. There was a racial dimension and there was an element of surprise, a lot of misinformation. The police was totally unable to respond, neither the military at that time. So in terms of security and infrastructure, it really was massive. Impacted on water security, food security, energy security, and health services. So a lot of lessons to be learned. Really going forward, I want to just shift the discussion into the new science thinking. And this emerged also this year during the COVID and during the looting. Our science community is really shifting from measuring the amount of money, the inputs that go into research, measuring the activities and the outputs, to a more, how can we measure the impact of research? So there's a definite shift from controlling research, influencing research, to shifting research into a sphere of interest. So within these, we think that the global shift on research networks is very important, transdisciplinary teams, and I'm going to say something of that. And then, of course, virtual programs. So it's no longer about doing research in your own country only. It is now about utilizing these massive international teams, connecting teams and really focusing on taking the research to the community, to the industry. So I think the science-driven policy change that we see is very interesting, and it will impact on everyone. I just want to mention three words, buzzwords, that we are using a lot in South Africa. We are talking about multidisciplinary research, interdisciplinary, transdisciplinary, and these three words are often used and intermingled. They actually mean different things. In the case of multidisciplinary, each specialist stay in their own field. It's the sum total of their knowledge. Interdisciplinary is focusing very much on those zones between the disciplines. And the third one, transdisciplinary, merging these into removing the boundaries between these disciplines. So I think we can expect a lot of interesting research and these global networks. In South Africa, we had a very good network of UK, EU, and USA, and also in Africa through RU Forum. That's changing. Our mushroom industries is now, this South African Mushroom Farmers Association is no longer funding research. And I've subsequently looked at this Australian Mushroom Growers Association and how you have now developed these platforms with training and extension. And I think it's absolutely fantastic. And I think timing is brilliant, and it's most certainly the future. Let's just look at food safety for a bit, and I'm sure you've seen a lot of this information, but I want to highlight a few things that I thought is important. And the one is product recall or brand. and damage to your brand or product. And we have seen this in the Listeria case in South Africa with Poloni. I was working on the Listeria case, and one of the first culprits in South Africa was actually mushrooms. That's one of the things they said, oh, isn't it mushrooms? Because we took about 6 months to figure out it was actually the Poloni. And the reason why they said mushrooms was that the first government sampling, it was one lettuce producer that they detected some Listeria, and that lettuce producer actually provided compost to the mushroom farms. So, and then they ended up saying, well, is it perhaps not mushrooms? And we couldn't find anything on mushrooms. We actually sampled all fresh produce. And at the end, it was baloney. But the impact of that delay detecting was damaging. It was damaging to the company. Until today, Tiger Brands is busy with a few big court cases. And people are really very anti-Tiger Brands. The brand has had incredible damage. And recently, we had a big product recall from Tiger Brand. It was Koo Can Beans. And people immediately, they lost their trust in the brand and in the company. So I want to mention something about product recall, because this was a case of product recall. It wasn't an outbreak. And that's a very different story. So this is just a summary of food safety. And this is more a historic perspective. So if we just look at the older information that we have, it was interesting to see in most of these countries, or America, Canada, EU, and then a little bit in China, and that was mostly Staphylococcus with canned mushrooms. But the fresh mushrooms was mostly Listeria. And of course, we also had, in this case, the Clostridia. This is some of the first reports. These were outbreaks. So you actually had people that got ill, died. So, and then Campylobacter. There's a lot of talk now about Campylobacter, also in the EU. Of course, we know the source. So it's very important to always go back to the source, in this case, chicken. So if, introduced through the chicken manure. And then, of course, with Listeria, we know it's a soil water feces problem. And once it's established in your facility, and that's what happened in South Africa, it was established in the processing plant. And once it was in the processing plant, they just could not get it out. In fact, they closed down the original plant where it was started. But I know a lot of our processing plants had Listeria in at the stage, a lot of problems around the drains. And it's a very difficult pathogen to remove once it's established. So I think it's a very important point around product recall. I was just looking at the period between 2008 and 17, what was really happening. And once again, a lot of Listeria activity and product recalls and outbreaks or alerts. And last one I want to show is just now more recent, 2021, 20. These have been more, very specifically more associated with recalls. And very importantly, this is through inspection services. So South Africa, we do not have a dedicated food control authority. Food safety is still a very under-supported program within government, and it's regulated, or not even effectively regulated, through different departments, Department of Agriculture, Department of Health. And as you all know, we're dealing with COVID, we're dealing with AIDS. So this is really not a big priority for us. But that's just a little bit of background on food safety. And I want to take you into the mushroom research we've been doing. And it's interesting, the mushroom industry in South Africa compared to the global market is really minute. We have 17 producers, 24 facilities. And it's an industry that had, during 2005, a bit of a increased sales, and after that we definitely now see a drop in sales with mushrooms. So it is getting more difficult in South Africa despite the health benefits. Research at the University of Pretoria was focused on five key programs. We developed alternative casing for peat. This project, I'll say something about that, that we ran for many years. And we then developed a mushroom gap based on global gap and mushroom food safety system. It was taken further by Denny's. In fact, the student who developed the mushroom gap for his master's is now working for Denny's mushrooms. And then we later on developed a disease diagnostics platform, mush drops, and I'll talk to you about that a little bit. And then the emphasis very much shifted to biosecurity, creating a global mushroom pathogen collection and a knowledge hub. Just to give you also a little bit of information, we've been funded by the industry over the last 20 years, just over 6 million rand. And we have really trained 11 postgrad students, 3 PhDs and 3 masters, published several papers, and particularly industry-specific papers in the spawn run. I just want to say something about the patent. We do have this mushroom patent for peat with Linda Mayer, and this patent resulted in a product, and she created a company called Mabu Casing, and they have developed this eco-friendly composting media based on the research that we've done. We've tested substrates at the University of Pretoria, more than 20 different combinations, and the innovation at the end was really about changing the raw substrate. They also had significant financial support from the Development Corporation in South Africa to start their business. And this is perhaps a nice, interesting example of from research to applied research. Impact, making an impact in industry. We focused on research, continued mainly on health and safety, where we looked at diversity and prevalence of fungal and bacterial pathogens, of course, the diagnostics, and more recently focusing on microbiomes. And I want to end my talk with a little bit of the microbiomes. Just looking at sanitation, pushing the farms to improve sanitation, developing an early warning system for our farms and preventing disease expression. So it's really reducing your inoculum on farm. Our farm reports go back to the farms, and we will report on the presence of any of these fungal pathogens. We will report on both whether we've picked up any disease expression and which pathogens we've detected. And then provide them a report on how to improve the facility. We actually developed these little mushroom kits, MPI kits, we call it. So we also leave these on farms. The farmer is also supplied with old toolbox where they then can do their own swabs in between. If they spot anything suspicious, they can send a sample and send to us, and we will then identify it rapidly for them, and they can then shift into a more effective control strategy. So sample collection, most farms were visited at least twice a year. We would do sampling throughout the facility, the compost yard, spawn rooms, and then in the environment around that. And you could see the girls even moving around on the track climbing, and it of course was great fun. We also did quite a lot of air sampling, and that to me was quite an important strategy because that's really your inoculum source, and that's really what you want to reduce. So the report for the farm would actually include what's on your walls, floors, air ducts, the door handles, anything that you touch, the trolleys. And most of our problems, funny enough, is usually the air ducts. And that's usually the first area we would suggest farmers would go and clean and improve the cleaning program. And then, of course, our sampling strategy was optimized. We used rice swabs, flock swabs, and followed basic published methods around DNA extraction. And also identification and adding these fungal pathogens to our culture collection. Of course, the normal procedures using real-time PCR and also developing the PCR, improving the technology. We developed a ddPCR methodology, and then we started focusing more on looking at the microbiome, the total microbial presence on the mushrooms, on the farm, so that we could give a better and improved breakdown for the farmers. This is just to give you a little bit of idea of, on a specific farm, how we would, in this case, trichoderma, take trichoderma, and then specifically the trends, so that we could say to farmers, you are getting a buildup, you better improve your cleaning. And every time after a report we would cut, it was effective, the cleaning, the farming cleaning is improved, and slowly you start getting a buildup. And then back to cleaning. We hope to flatten the curve, sounds like COVID talk, over time. We also looked at the library of pathogens that we detected on farms, whether it was on the composting area, the preparation area, or the production area. So once you move into production, your trichoderma just exploded. So if you already detected the compost area, or the preparation area, you know you most likely will really have a big problem in the production area. These are just the mycogeny and cladobotrym, so some of the other pathogens. This is also just comparing standard culture methods. If you use standard culture methods for your sampling versus PCR, this is just for trichoderma aggressivum, you can see the improved detection if we use an optimized ddPCR method. This cladobotrym, and once again, enhanced detection, and here you have some of the other pathogens, perhaps less so for mycogeny. So these are very interesting, and you can also see the effectiveness of this, whether it's in production area, preparation, or composting. Another very interesting area that we focused on recently is the combination of symptoms. We're developing an app, we've got an AI project to try and do machine learning so that we can link this spots with the pathogen and the disease, so that it can become a tool for the farm to immediately, the minute they see a spot developing, to try and immediately identify it and then also remove it. So, specifically in South Africa, we have seen an incredible increase in trichoderma aggressivum, the green mold, of course, with the other pathogens still hovering in the background. We also now have an increased presence of some of our pseudomonas, Tulasie gingeri, and of course, the fluorescence. And this is also an increasing concern for our mushroom farmers. So some of the standard optimized methods that we've really focused on, and also the methods for the microbiome studies that we've optimized, and just looking, and this is specifically is one student working on the case of penicilliums, and she was also looking at pseudomonas. So a lot of work happening, and more recently we've started looking at raw mushrooms and the microbial composition of a raw mushroom, the contribution to the human gut health. So this is quite important. This is part of the global big talk, as how can you shift your microbial gut microflora by changing your diet? And we want to really use this to change your microflora on the mushroom can actually help you improve your health by changing your micro gut flora. Just interesting, we've looked at microbial load on mushrooms, and this is the average load that we found between all the different farms, and that a normal mushroom would carry more roughly that log colony forming units per gram. I just want to touch on some of the fungal microbiome work. This is, for instance, looking at compost, essing material. And this was just optimizing methods. This was using different extraction kits. And just to quickly explain to everyone, I personally think the results is as good as the method you use. So it's always very important to look at the kind of method. This, for instance, is interesting because with this method, you hardly pick up any of Lifeliaceae, the family of Lifeliaceae. That's the brown group over here. You actually also don't pick up any of the glucaceae. So there's definitely a different picture that will emerge depending on the method that you use. What's also important is that there is a difference and a shift that we see between composting and casing. If you take it a little bit further and you look at a phyllo level, you can also see the impact of methods, but also the difference between compost and casing. I can take it a step further, this for bacteria or fungi, and you can see how these populations change as the mushrooms start growing and the microbes that's carried over from your compost casing onto your mushrooms. And those we thought was quite interesting. So a lot of information, a lot of work done. Yes, once again, in the case of bacteria, and you can see the incredible diversity, a lot of the streptomycia, and a lot of diversity during the casing phase compared to the compost phase. Here we have quite a lot of protea bacteria, bacterioides, and it's interesting, this is your termite, so-called termite group of bacteria and protea bacteria. And that's, of course, is more interesting for us from a food safety point of view, because that's where we have E. coli, salmonella, and of course, also it includes the nitrogen fixing group of organisms. So once again, for bacteria and fungi, if you compare your mushrooms, a lot of interesting things we can do, and it can provide a lot of valuable information. We've published some of these papers and try to use this information to talk to farmers and say, well, when do you have a healthy mushroom and when you have a symptomatic mushroom, who's the bad guys that we need to control? So valuable tools for and to impact on the industry and make a difference. So from a food safety point of view, we've really focused on these Listeria, Salmonella, and Staphylococcus, and more recently, very importantly, antibiotic resistance. So this is a big shift, not only in South Africa, but in the whole fresh produce industry. We have a project with the United Nations now looking at developing a new codex standard for fresh produce. And there's also quite a lot of antibiotic resistance groups in government. So a lot of talk and change about the presence of these pathogens. I want to thank the research group at the University of Pretoria, and very importantly, thank the Australian mushroom industry for inviting me to give this talk. Thank you very much. Very quiet.
Ah, there, I'm back. Sorry, my computer froze for a moment then. And it was just like, I'm trying to click it and nothing's happening. Thank you so much, Lise. That was really interesting. And you touched on such a wide range of subjects, I felt. But I really liked your story about, was it tiger brands? And you said that they were associated with the finds of Listeria, and they have never recovered, even though it wasn't them.
Yes, so this is very important. Yeah, so I hear what you say, but the impact on a brand is so big, you know, that one has to be so careful. So now in South Africa last week, they asked me to talk on television because of this product recall. Mm-hmm. But just because it was Tiger Brands, it immediately exploded in the media, and people didn't want to buy these coup cans. And it's such a good tool to do a product recall. If you detect something, rather do a product recall than have an outbreak, because the impact of the outbreak is so big. And that really destroys your brand. And that's the example we saw around bologna. And it wasn't even only bologna, but the impact was huge. People stopped eating bologna.
Yeah. So what's bologna?
So bologna is a sausage. It's a big sausage. Italian.
Okay.
I should have given you a picture of it. Every child in South Africa went to school with a piece of bologna, this cold meat slice on his sandwich. And that's how the outbreak actually detected, in a little preschool where they had these cut sliced bologna.
Right, I see. Yes. Yes, well, it's very, and I mean, it's, I think it's important that, like, there are all those detections of Listeria mono on mushrooms, but none have actually resulted in an outbreak.
Exactly. Yeah.
So this is, but I mean, it's really interesting to see how the finger is immediately pointed as mushrooms, because we've got compost, and so therefore it must be the mushrooms, and it wasn't, but the brand reputational damage is so great. So it's a really salient lesson, I think, for our industry. And it's, you know, I think why the Australian industry has been so focused on being prepared for exactly this sort of eventuality. So that was a really good story. Now, Jeff has asked what sort of legislation there is in South Africa surrounding the health claims on mushroom nutrition. So I guess the vitamin D issue, and what you can say about gut health.
The guts, I'll come back to the gut health story just now. The vitamin D and the cancer drive is a very strong initiative. There's no formal legislative framework in place. So the vitamin D story is something we are trying to brand now. It's something we told the mushroom industry, we think now during COVID they should really push and brand and take further. But the legislative framework in South Africa is so fragmented and outdated that it goes back to labeling, and they have changed the labeling legislation. And most of the claims is around GMO, and there's a big debate around the GMO, but not as much around, there is the nutritional requirements that you need to put on your labeling, but nothing yet around the claims around vitamin D, for instance, or a better product to use during COVID, for instance. There's a big hype around ginger and COVID, and the ginger sales in South Africa exploded. So,
Really? Wow. Yes, well, I think our neighbor sells rosehip products, and their sales went through the roof as well. So, yeah. Now, Mohammed has asked, how can Listeria contaminate mushrooms in growing rooms? Is it mainly through casing soil, or is it through other things?
That's very important. It gets introduced through the people walking in, and that's why your flow of people is so important. So in the big factories in South Africa during the Listeria outbreak, and so by the way, it was the biggest outbreak in the world. We had more than 200 people who died and more than 2,000 people that were sick. And it took almost 2 years, from detection to bringing it back under control. But what was interesting was they were spraying in the big factories, the workers under their boots, spraying with ethanol. So the whole theory was that if you people walk and move between different processing plants, so you would have an abattoir area maybe, and then they move into the processing part of the factory, that transmission came in through the movement of people. Not necessarily your raw material. There was a big debate around whether it came in with the poultry. There was a big debate about it was maybe poultry coming in from Brazil. Then it was the pork industry was blamed. And then it was compost. So there was, in the beginning, a whole lot of different industries blamed until they settled down on the bologna story. But the message is very clear. You have to manage your hygiene. The problem is once it's in your processing plant or your packing plant, it's always around the drains. And those were the hot spots in those facilities. And they just couldn't get the drains. The listeria really persisted in that drain area. And it's almost like an area around the drain that you could actually, through air sampling, detect it. So that was really interesting.
I mean, I guess like listeria monocytogenes is actually pretty common in the environment. It's just that in those sort of wet areas, it can multiply to much larger populations.
So I want to say that Listeria mono is not so prevalent. We've been sampling all the farms. So I showed you a lot on Pseudomonas, but we don't pick up Listeria like that. So it's not that we find it commonly on any of our vegetables. We pick up a lot of salmonella, yes, and particularly salmonella on certain crops. Some of the horticultural fruit crops we would find salmonella on citrus, for instance, or some of your leafy greens. But it's not such a big problem for us. And listeria, we definitely do not pick up on fresh produce. And it's not common in our soils. But if it gets introduced in your facility, that's when it starts amplifying. And that's when it's difficult to control.
So while we're on this topic, Joe has asked, how important are the three key mushroom pathogens on whole mushrooms versus sliced? Does the microflora on whole mushrooms protect or prevent pathogen proliferation on the whole? That's a big question, I think.
a good question.
It is, yes.
The minute you start slicing, you introduce your whole microflora change, because you now have more from the product contributing to the shift in your population. And of course, the longer you keep a cut product, the quicker the decay process. So there's a definite shift in your spoilage microbes, because it's, once again, the handling step. So every time you introduce handling, you get those shifts happening in the population. And those shifts is usually the imbalancing between your protected, the microbes that protect, and the microbes that then break it down and start the degradation process. So it's about spoilage, more rapid spoilage and more shifts in that.
Right. Now I've got another question from Jeff, which was about the marbu casing and whether is industry using the marbu casing? Because then, I mean, you'd think like with the IPCC report, and one of the first things that they mentioned in terms of reducing carbon emissions from countries is peat. And so finding alternatives to peat, whether in whole or in part, you'd think is key. And the marbu casing is the one commercial product which is a viable alternative. So
it is.
Yes. Is it being used, though, currently?
It was used at one stage on a test trial basis by, for instance, Denny's mushrooms. There was also a few farms, smaller farms, that tried. But at the moment, it wasn't sustainable. I think they're using a lot of that product more now in horticulture. And the whole company has shifted more to the horticultural industry. I don't know if it's more profitable. And our mushroom farmers also still prefer to import the peat. But now, obviously, during COVID, where we had all our ports closed down, and we had actually a supply challenge with product coming in. And then, of course, with the looting with Durban Harbour being closed, the product was, you know, product couldn't move through the harbours. So I think it's very important that the industry revisit a product such as marbu casing, and or develop their own products. We have to find alternatives.
Yeah, I tend to agree. So do you think that they might now with the where are they currently buying peat from? Does the South African Ireland. Industry Ireland? It's Irish.
It's through a Dutch company. Right. Most of this volumes coming in
It must be a significant cost.
Very significant cost.
So you'd think the marbu casing would be a more economic alternative potentially.
Yes, but you know, talking about global warming, And the reality with of temperature increase 1.5 degrees, whatever we're facing, all the fires we've been dealing with globally, I think the reality of that we have to start changing the way we deal with the environment is so important. So we have to find better ways of growing our mushrooms. It has to be more environmental friendly. And really to move peat halfway around the world with your energy footprint, I don't think it's a sustainable way. And I don't think it's environmental friendly either. Mm. So I think we have to change the way we produce our food.
Yep. So Muhammad had asked if there's any work on using spent mushroom compost as casing. And I know this is a topic dear to his heart because he's done a lot of work on spent mushroom casing as compost.
Yes, there was some work initially done in South Africa on that. It was done on a small scale at one stage, but once again at the moment, not. I also want to say we don't have a lot of mushroom farmers left at the moment. Mm. So the mushroom industry is really quite small at the moment. So not current using as much, but it has been investigated.
Right. Okay. There was another thing. Like I saw that you said that there's a big problem with trichoderma in South Africa. And it seems to be increasing. And yeah. I wondered if you had any comments about why you thought it was increasing and whether do the farms there cook out or how are they managing it?
Okay, so yeah, we definitely see an increase. There's a nice case study that I can use. We saw one compost yard was delivering to three farms. And we started picking up the trichoderma and the one compost farm. And it was within the next visit, we actually picked up quite a lot of trichoderma on the other farms, on all three farms. So it definitely came in through the compost yard from there to the different three different production units. And it then just increased. And then we actually started with a deep clean. We looked at removing of the waste. There was a lot of waste dump areas near the growing room. So we looked at the whole outlay of the farm, the movement of people, the movement of raw product into and the spent compost out of and the cooking procedures. And once we started focusing on hotspot areas and cleaning it out, we could bring it down. So I thought it was actually a classic example of it's all about the management. And any disease, you need to really manage and you need to focus on the hotspots. And, you know, exactly the same for Listeria. If you start picking it up, you need to focus rather on the hotspots and remove it and clean it and change it.
Well, it was an interesting graph of yours where the trichoderma ramps up and then they do a massive clean and it disappears and then it slowly, slowly comes up again in another massive clean. So it's, you know, it's such a hard thing to control, trichoderma. Right. So if we've got any other questions, you seem to have been through most of them. I did have another question. Okay. You mentioned about, well, you showed those very interesting charts of how fungi and bacteria are carried through from the compost to the casing and then onto the mushrooms. And onto the mushrooms, there weren't so many organisms present. And yet, you also said there was an average 8.7 CFU per gram microbial load on the mushrooms at harvest. So these are all, they're good bacteria and fungi. So it's an amazing to think that there's such an enormous range of fungi and bacteria that are present and how they might then be used to control diseases during production.
So I want to say two things. So you can measure your total microbial load on a mushroom and you can, and in South Africa, we used a guideline from the Department of Health to say that at the point of consumption, a fresh product, and that included mushrooms, should not have more than so many log colony-forming units. It was then considered not fit for consumption. And that has changed. They've actually withdrawn that guideline. So it's an old guideline that was used particularly in the airline industry when they serve food to the consumers. So they've now changed it and they've realized it's not a good measure to say that you shouldn't have this total load of microorganisms. Methodology also changed. That's why I showed you the graph between what a PCR or what a if you look at the total microbiome, the picture you get from that will be very different from what you can then isolate. So it's about viable, which means what you can actually cultivate, which is really 1% of what's really present or was present on that product. So it tells you different stories, the different techniques that we can use. But the most important story is about if there's a pathogen present, and usually you can pick them up in a low concentration, then you already need to start controlling them, whether it's a Listeria or whether it's a trichoderma. And the method you use to selectively enrich, which is the method we use for Listeria, because you don't just get a lot of Listeria, you have to go and look for it, you have to increase it. So we use selective enrichment. Once we've got it, you can say you are going to get a problem. So the methodology and what you're looking for is very important to interpret it correctly and to use it correctly.
Yeah. Well, that is the thing. Yeah. Well, the detection methods for Listeria are so sensitive that that's why, you know, you can detect it, but that doesn't mean that there's enough there to actually cause illness and so on. So we've got another question about Listeria. In HACCP systems, critical control points have to be identified. Regarding Listeria, would you say that the people flowing in and out of the farm is a critical control point?
That's a very good question, because in this big factory that I visited, the boots were. But it's one of the big factories preparing food, so they will make sandwiches with mushroom or avo sandwiches or pizzas. And they had high care parts of the factory and then medium and low care and prep units. And they used boots and they had a whole schedule for boot cleaning. And they, during the Listeria outbreak, they literally walked on the floor and blow a whistle every 15 minutes. And then all the workers had to lift their shoes and spray. And then they also sprayed all the conveyor belts. Now, I don't know if that reduced the problem, because the hotspots remained positive. They would clean it. They would use a lot of detergents. And then coming back a week or two later, then, you know, the Listeria was detected again. So, yes, I don't think it shouldn't be, but it's also about your surroundings. So if you have a compost yard directly next to your pack house, the likelihood of workers moving from the one area to the other area and moving things into your sensitive area becomes critical, and you need to manage it.
Yeah. So in that case, they definitely are a critical control point. Yeah. So maybe we'll end on this question. I think it's a good question to finish up on. So Joe has asked, in your view, what is the biggest challenge for the mushroom industry in the next 5 to 10 years? You want to think about that for a moment?
Now, I can tell you straight out, there's incredible opportunity for the mushroom industry because of two things. There's a global realization that we need to move away from meat. We can see it in our Woolworths, which is our top retail store in South Africa. My daughter's a vegan, so she could never find anything to buy. Now there's two rows of shelves full of different vegan products, amongst others, mushroom patty, mushroom mince, mushroom this. So mushrooms have now become important as a meat replacement in the diet.
Yep.
So I think from that point of view, I think the industry will grow, should grow, and should change their marketing strategy. I also think the health contribution from increasing the consumption of mushrooms will be vital in this whole healthier approach towards living. And I think those are two key things that COVID taught us. We have to change the way we buy, prepare, and what we consume. And I think that's an opportunity for the mushroom industry to explore. I think the fact that people were looking at having little mushroom growing boxes at home was another very interesting thing. And I think home gardens will be another concept that's going to grow in the future, because the distribution system has been severely affected. The shipping liners, the problems with containers. We have a shortage of containers in South Africa. And very interestingly, I must tell you the story before I go. Recently, our ports were hacked. And
by whom? So,
cybercrime. And it was so serious that they couldn't track the containers at the ports. So the big network in South Africa was so severely affected that we had a period of 2 weeks where we had serious problems with getting containers or moving your containers through the ports. And they couldn't be tracked or traced. And we have never seen this before. So it really severely affected food flows in South Africa. So I think we need to take note of cybercrime and the importance of that.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. All right. So I think we're just about out of time anyway. So we might finish it there. But thank you so much, Liz, for getting up very early in the morning, I should say. It's only... about 6 o'clock now, so it's the best time of the day, so people tell me. So thank you for doing a great job on such a wide range of interesting subjects, and you know, it's interesting to see the differences between our industry and South Africa, but also the similarities. So I think it's a really interesting story. So this webinar has been recorded. We will be sending a link to the recording to everyone who's registered, and it will be placed on our website as well. So it's widely available, and please feel free to pass on the link. This webinar has been brought to you thanks to the Marsh Lawson Mushroom Research Centre Project, MU16004, funded through the Mushroom Levy with funds from the Australian Government. Thank you, and we hope to see you again next time, I think 3 weeks to the next webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And thank you, Liz. And excellent. And we shall be in touch about food safety.
Thank you very much.